Yeah, just give me a just give me a signal type and it's done. Welcome to the Rural Futures Talk Show. I'm Robin Eastman, an associate with the Assam-based NGO Balipara Foundation. The objective of the show today is to bring you a multi-layered perspective on some of the issues concerning climate change and conservation. Let me introduce you to our panel of speakers right over here. On my near right is Ms. Eliza Boro. She's one of the founders and currently secretary of the Mahila Sakti Kendra. It's an NGO based out of the Balipara of the Sonitpur district in Assam. Working with a consortium of about 150 SHGs, Mrs. Eliza Boro and her organization have impacted for the better the lives of countless women across rural and forest range communities. But before she could accomplish all of this, she herself had to first struggle and then break free from the clutches of tradition that society typically enforces upon its women. Kolumbai Baido. To the right of Baido, we have Mr. Anis Andheria, who is an educator, wildlife photographer, author, motivational speaker, all rolled into one energetic bundle. As the president of Wildlife Conservation Trust, he oversees conservation programs across 160 national parks and wildlife sanctuaries across 23 states in India. Anis, good to have you here.
Same here.
Our third participant today is Mrs. Liza Mills from the United States of America. A close friend of mine, Liza is a grassroots conservation educator with the University of Montana. She has worked and traveled extensively in the Udalguri district of Assam and in parts of Bhutan over the last decade. She is devoted to the cause of elephant conservation and spends much of her time and energy developing ideas for their benefit. Liza, good to see you again.
Thank you.
So we'll start off proceedings by hearing first from Eliza Baido. I'll converse in Assamese with Baido. Baido, aji apni bahut dinor para gaon ancholor manuh logot kam kori ase. Ar ami sobe jano ki apnar Balipara area 1980s aur 1990s aur bahut kini deforestation hoise. আজিও আপোনাৰ মেন এলিফেণ্ট কনফ্লিক্টৰ কাৰণে বহুত প্ৰব্লেম হৈ থাকে আপুনি আমাক এটা কথা কওক যেতিয়া আপুনি গাঁৱৰ মানুহবিলাকৰ লগত কথা হয় আলোচনা হয় তেতিয়া কনজাৰ্ভেশ্যন বা ক্লাইমেট চেঞ্জৰ ওপৰত কথা কিবা হয়নে আৰু যদি হয় কি ধৰণৰ কথা হয়
যিটো আমাৰ যিটো অঞ্চলত আমি কাম কৰোঁ য'ৰ পৰা আমি আহিছোঁ তাতে সেই অঞ্চলত কি হয় তেনেকুৱা ক্লাইমেট চেঞ্জ এইবিলাকৰ ওপৰত তেনেকুৱা একো গাঁও অঞ্চলত যিটো হয় তাতে এনেকুৱা কথা একো পতা নহয় সেইবিলাকৰ বিষয়ে চিন্তাও ইমানকৈ নকৰে আৰু প্ৰায় মানুহবিলাকৰ আৰ্থিক অৱস্থা একদম বেয়া তো মানুহৰ কি হয় আজিৰ চিন্তাটো বেছিকৈ কৰে ভৱিষ্যতৰ চিন্তাটো কৰিবলৈ সেইটো সময় নাই আৰু ইমান সেইটো ভাবিলেও মানে এইটো এইটোৰ ওপৰত বেছি কথা নহয় আৰু যিবিলাক ল'ৰা ছোৱালী গাঁৱৰ আছে স্কুল পঢ়ে তেখেতসকলে ষ্টুডেণ্টবিলাকে অলপ পাতে কিন্তু তেনেকৈ একো চিন্তা নকৰে মানে আজি কাম কৰিছে আজি খাইছে কালি হেৰি কৰিছে তেনেকুৱা কিন্তু যেতিয়া সেইটো সময়ত বহুত গছ কাটিলে হেৰি হ'ল তাৰপিছত এতিয়া দেখিছে যে খৰি নাই প্ৰব্লেমবিলাক আহিছে মানুহৰ খৰি নাই খৰি এতিয়া ওচৰত নাপায় গছ কাটি খতম হৈ গ'ল তাৰপিছত তাৰ পৰা বোল্ডাৰ উলিয়ায় তেনেকুৱা সমস্যা তো সেইবিলাক লৈ যায় নিয়াৰ ফলত কি হয় গোটেই বোল্ডাৰবোৰ পথাৰত আহি গৈছে এতিয়া মানুহৰ সমস্যাটো হৈছে তাৰপিছত যেতিয়া বৰষুণ লাগে নাপায় কেতিয়াবা পানী বেছি হয় কেতিয়াবা পানী নাই খোৱা পানীৰো সমস্যা আগতে পানীৰটো পাইছিলে এতিয়া পানী নাথাকে কোনোবা সময়ত খাবৰ কাৰণে কুঁৱা শুকাই যায় মাৰ্চ মাহৰ সময়ত তেনেকুৱা সমস্যাবিলাক যেতিয়া আহিছে তেতিয়া যেতিয়া মানুহবিলাকে এতিয়া ভাবিবলৈ মানে বাধ্য হৈছে মানে চিন্তা কৰিছে তাৰপিছত গ্ৰুপবিলাকে কি কৰে এইবিলাক ওপৰত আলোচনা হয় যে আমাৰ এনেকুৱা এনেকুৱা এতিয়া সমস্যা হৈ আছে এইটো আমি কেনেকৈ সমাধান কৰিব পাৰোঁ তেনেকৈ গ্ৰুপবিলাকে আলোচনা কৰি পেলাই কিছুমান মানে নিজাকে তেনেকৈ অলপ হেৰি কৰিছে এইটো বচাব লাগে এনেকুৱা বুলি হেৰি কৰি গ্ৰুপে লগ লাগি পেলাই কিছুমান ঠাইত মানে খালী ঠাইবিলাকত এনেকৈ গছ ফল মূলৰ গছ গছনি ৰুব ধৰিছে যাতে খৰিটো ওচৰতে পায়
এইটো ডাঙৰ হ'ব
হয় তো তেনেকৈ এতিয়া এইটো চিন্তাটো কৰিব আৰম্ভ কৰিছে
আৰু আপোনালোকে যোনটো 160টা আপোনাৰ ছেল্ফ হেল্প গ্ৰুপৰ লগত কাম কৰি আছে সেইবিলাক সেইবিলাক কামটো বেছিভাগ চাগে লাইভলিহুডৰ বিষয়ে ওপৰত হৈ আছে আপোনালোকে কেনেকৈ ষ্টাৰ্ট কৰিছিলে ছেল্ফ হেল্প গ্ৰুপবিলাক তো ষ্টাৰ্টিঙত কেনেকৈ আছিলে আজিৰ দিনত আপোনালোকে কেনেকুৱা টাইপৰ কাম কৰি আছে আৰু আগলৈ কেনেকুৱা কাম কৰিম বুলি ভাবিছে
আমি যেতিয়া প্ৰথম আত্মসহায়ক গোট আছিলে ছেল্ফ হেল্প গ্ৰুপ গঠন কৰিছিলে সেইটো সময়ত গ্ৰুপবিলাক গাঁৱত এইটো সঞ্চয় এইবিলাক কৰিছিলে তাৰপিছত যিকোনো গাঁৱৰ সমস্যা সেইবিলাকৰ ওপৰত আলোচনা কৰে, ঘৰুৱা হিংসা এইবিলাকৰ ওপৰত, তো তেনেকুৱা সেইবিলাক কাম কৰা হয়। কিন্তু পিছলৈ দেখিছে যে এইটো পিছত কি কৰিছে, গাঁও খেতি বাতিৰ ওপৰত এতিয়া কাম কৰিব আৰম্ভ কৰিছে লাইভলিহুডত, তো নিজৰ বাৰীতে নিজৰ চাকৰিটো ওলায়, বাহিৰলৈ যাব নালাগে, তো তেনেকুৱা। তো সেইটো কৰোঁতে কি হয়, নিজৰ ঘৰখনতে গছ গছনি লগায়, তাৰপৰা ইনকামটো আহে লাহেকৈ, খৰিও ওচৰতে পাব, তেনেকুৱা মানে আলোচনা হয়, তাৰ মাধ্যমেৰে মানে এইটো কৰা হৈছে, আগতে সেইবিলাক চিন্তা কৰা নাছিলে।
ঠিক আছে, সো অনিশ, আইল গেট বেক টু ইউ। ইউ নো বেসিক্যালি হোয়াট লিজা বাইডো ওয়াজ সেইং দ্যাট জো গ্রুপ হে, ইউ নো দ্য গ্রাস রুট পিপল জো হে, জব উনকা থোড়া বাত হোতা হে, দে টকিং অ্যাবাউট ইস্যুস রিলেটেড টু ইউ নো দে ডে টু ডে লাইফ, দ্য নেগেটিভ অ্যাবাউট কনজারভেশন অর ইউ নো ক্লাইমেট চেঞ্জ ইজ প্রিটি মাচ নন এক্সিস্টেন্ট, দ্যাট ইউ অলরেডি নো হ্যাভিং ওয়ার্ক এক্সটেন্সিভলি ইন সো মেনি ন্যাশনাল পার্কস অ্যান্ড উইথ সো মেনি ফরেস্ট রেঞ্জ কমিউনিটিস। নাও হাউ ইজ অ্যান অর্গানাইজেশন সে লাইক WCT, দ্য ওয়ান দ্যাট ইউ আর লিডিং, অ্যান্ড দ্য মেনি অর্গানাইজেশন দ্যাট আর ইনভলভ in wildlife conservation and climate change, how does that reflect on the strategies or an action plan, or what are you guys doing specifically to address that?
Yeah, see, I completely understand that local communities don't look at everything from the glass of climate change. However, when you talk to them, jab aap unse baat karte hain jaakar, so they have anecdotes. They say that you know, 20 years ago
that's what even Baido was mentioning. Yes.
So the yield was so much, and now it is dropped.
Yes.
Especially when you go in the Himalayas, the fruiting has changed, the seasons have changed, pollination has got affected, bees have stopped producing the kind of honey that they used to, because the breeding time of the bees and the blooming of the flowers is not synchronized. So they are not able to connect it to climate change, but you get indirect and direct evidence when you talk to people. So as a NGO and as people who are trying to improve their adaptability, because eventually climate change now is real, it's going to be there. We are talking of reducing carbon emissions across the planet so that the temperature rise can be restricted to 2%, but all of us know that no matter what we do now, it will touch about 3.5%. And already you are seeing that yields of so many important cash crops have gone down.
True.
Why I'm talking, see, conservation is not only about animals. Conservation is about striking a balance between human use, so it's land use, and of wildlife and the forests.
True.
Because finally, we know that in India, you are looking at about 21.23%, which means 1/5 of our country is classified as forest.
True.
However, only 5% of India is protected area, which means it is either national park, sanctuary, conservation reserve, or community reserve. And a majority of our rivers are originating from that 5% of India.
True.
The remaining forest, obviously there is a large chunk of forest, but it is degraded and severely in some cases. There are places where you go, you can't even say it is a forest, but it's classified as forest.
True.
Another big issue is with the burgeoning development and the linear infrastructure that's happening, which means the roads are being built, railways are coming up. There is fragmentation. So the degraded forest is further fragmented. So these are real issues.
True.
And as we go ahead in time, there will be further fragmentation. So at a national level, you are looking at the developmental projects, things which are inevitable. At the micro level, you are looking at the impact of the climate change on communities. So you, with science, technology, and experience, are able to piece all these things together.
True.
And so it's therefore what we do is we, keeping the bigger picture in mind, we try to find solutions at a micro scale. And because we work in 23 states, you have to constantly adapt to different communities. Because not only state, within the state, within districts, there is difference in culture. And so it's not easy, it's quite challenging. And we know that because of climate change, who is going to be impacted the most? It is the poorest of the poor.
True.
And every state has the forest communities And most of these are the poorest of the poor today. Mm. So they are actually living in green areas which are sequestering carbon. So the only real solution to climate change is to bring the forest back.
Right.
So they are actually there, yet they have water scarcity because the rivers are drying. They have, and because of climate change, certain pathogens, disease are spreading.
Mm.
And so a malaria, which was unheard of in certain higher altitude areas, now are talking about malaria. So that population was never immune to that because they've never exposed to it. Now suddenly those populations are. So there are many, many things happening. Forest fires, the intensity and the frequency of forest fires has gone up because the soil moisture content has gone down. The moisture in the air also gets impacted in certain times of the year, because of which there is forest fire. When that happens, huge amount of natural resource gets damaged. And remember that these people who live in the forest are in a way dependent on the forest. So they may be agrarian, but they still depend on for protein and a lot of other things, especially in the Northeast, where culturally there is a very, very strong bond between people and the forest. And there is bushmeat hunting that goes on. But with climate change coming in and the populations that have gone up, it is no longer sustainable, which means they will need to eat.
Absolutely.
And they cannot then go and take wild meat from the forest because that's not there. And there are other things at play because of which the populations are, so the recruitment rates have gone down. So it's a extremely difficult thing to tackle. So we don't get into the big picture when we talk to the committees. We see what their problems are and we try to either retrofit certain things or bring in something that has worked somewhere else. So and one of the most critical thing is to get communities to talk to communities, because some people in the same district have found solutions to water scarcity by moving into a different kind of agriculture. So rather than preaching, we bring these communities together and then the dissemination of information goes. So that's the kind of stuff.
Because I'm sure working 160, you know, national parks and forests, there must have been quite a few like really good success stories across the years.
Correct. But one thing about conservation is that all your successes are temporary. All your failures are permanent.
Yeah, that is true.
And so you can succeed today, but things change. The political scenario changes.
Forest border changes.
There is drought suddenly. There is flooding suddenly. For 5 years, everything went well and suddenly it get wiped off. But I think the beauty about the country is that there is an umbilical cord between people and wildlife. So with 1.3 billion people and a lot of it, majority of them poor, there is still space for large mammals. Most places across the world, Africa is considered to be a mecca for large mammals. But the lion populations have collapsed because of hunting. Elephants have been decimated. 35,000 elephants massacred in a year. That's the rate at which animals are going. Whereas in India, with all these issues, where people have not enough to eat, yet they have place in their hearts for wildlife. We cannot take that for granted, because I can see since we started working, already the tolerance of certain communities have gone down.
Absolutely.
We cannot take it for granted. But however, so we and organizations like us, and not only us, even the government is piggybacking on the culture and the natural heritage that we have. So that is, I think, if we keep in our heads, it's very clear that the communities have solutions to the problems. You just have to bring your wisdom and try and fine-tune those so that they are relevant today. So that's the thing. Rather than telling them what to do, you need to see that their strengths are in agriculture. Then how do you shape that with your understanding from other parts of the world or other parts of the country? So I think we are more like a facilitator. We don't go and give them, or we don't preach, because it doesn't work that way. That's the, and we've learned a lot and we continue to learn.
So Lisa, I'll come to you now.
Okay.
See, you have had a fair share of experience working in this landscape in Assam, in Dalguri district, and then in Bhutan. You have worked with big NGOs, with small NGOs. You have worked with grassroots volunteers, with grassroots communities. So can you just shed some light on some of the positive experiences that you have had in our landscape?
Well, I started by living in Bhutan. My husband is a wildlife biologist, and we were there, and our children are in village school. So the issue of transboundary populations of elephants and other animals was really of interest to us, because we recognized that any group alone may not be able to tackle the bigger issues, but we were in a position to be able to bring together groups to begin discussion. And my project began with education. It was really just starting it as an elephant education program, but I quickly saw that we needed to do something very different. We were working in a landscape where different languages were being spoken, different countries were involved. Yeah. And so what we did is we just put cameras into the hands of local people, and we had a lot of involvement and excitement over young people engaging and taking cameras and telling their story of what was happening with elephants. And then we began to take this information and map it and see that many things were happening to elephants and to people from these conflicts of basically a landscape that was developing to the point where elephants were basically forced into a beggar situation. They're trying to move between villages and tea gardens and into fragments of forests to survive. And so what to do with that? We engaged a lot of people through a project called Elephants on the Line, and a lot of these same folks are still really interested in conservation, and have here through the Balapara Foundation, a number of people have come over to do reforestation as a result, kind of follow up from that project that we're very happy about. So when our grant ended, Balapara took over with the Odogari Landscape Mission Project. And then I've continued to look at those dots on the map that were in tea estates and around their edges and in even small tea gardens, and see there's a lot happening with agriculture impacts on elephant populations. So engaging more people would be to include the tea growers. Mm. And so we've begun to do that through a project called Elephant Friendly Tea, and kind of coming up with